Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I am Buzz, from the notorious Tap Out crew. Is it me, or is it getting cold in here? Who's in the house? The Iceman's in the house. I'm talking about Chuck Liddell.
Chuck Liddell.
A professional killer. An assassin. Aggressive.
Intolerant.
Chuck is really a stand-up guy, and before that, I thought Chuck was racist. I never saw anybody black in his camp, in his whole career.
Unrelenting. Tenacious. Can you feel me?
Can you feel me?
You want to step to the Iceman?
The Iceman.
You're going to get knocked out.
What's happening, ladies and gentlemen? Welcome to Fights Gone By, episode C7. It's your boy Jack Slack, returning triumphantly from defeating my illness. I still sound a bit like shit. You'll just have to get used to the voice, and we'll see how it goes. But it's been too long. It's been a couple of weeks since I've done an episode. And I've been trying. I just have had no voice at all. I was ill, and then I was well, but I was well and I couldn't actually speak. And it was really annoying me. So we'll catch up on all the shit we missed. Well, I don't know if we can do all the shit we missed. For some reason, whenever I'm not around, everything in the world happens in MMA. Whereas other weeks, I'm struggling to get together enough material about Junior Dos Santos versus Blagoy Ivanov. I've been slagging that fight off a lot lately. But I think that's well-deserved, to be honest. We had the equivalent this weekend with Alistair Overeem versus Mr. Tune-Up, whatever his name was, Pavlovich. Big Russian dude with almost no skills. But I think the thing that everyone really wants to talk about is Chuck versus Tito 3, and we'll have a good, righteous rant about that in a minute. But I suppose we better do some news, but there's tons of stuff going. Firstly, can I have a round of applause, please, for calling exactly what Mayweather versus Tenshin Nasukawa was? I was like, Floyd's full of shit, Sakigabara's full of shit, it'll be a boxing exhibition at best. And it is a boxing exhibition. They are paying Floyd millions of dollars, possibly hundreds of millions of dollars, for 9 minutes of work. Doesn't get much stupider than that, but they have got all eyes on Tenshin. Like, the entire 3 weeks since this was announced has been Reddit MMA posting clips of Tenshin being like, no one talks about Tenshin. Why is no one talking about Tenshin? Like, Tenshin's on the front page every fucking day. He did just beat, what's his name, Naito or whatever. Oh, it's probably not Naito. Someone will get pissy. I didn't watch it, but he did just beat a legit kickboxer. But, you know, a boxing exhibition is not main event level stuff. It's not hundreds of millions of dollars level stuff, but that's apparently what Ryzen want to do. However, I would say that a 3-round exhibition favours Tenshin a bit more than a full 10-round fight. Because he has exactly the same thing as McGregor. He fights on a hair trigger, he throws big counters very, very hard, and he tires in the later rounds. And he has typically tired in the later rounds against Suakim and Rod Tang. You know, he got very tired around round 3, and then he was just awful in round 4 and round 5. But, you know, Floyd, if he fought 10 rounds with Floyd, Floyd would just walk him down and do exactly the same thing he did to McGregor. Whereas in 3 rounds, Tenshin can just throw as hard as he wants from the opening bell. And then the onus is on Floyd to tie up and make stuff not happen. But if anyone can make stuff not happen, it's Floyd Mayweather. He is very, very good at that. In fact, they were talking to Canelo this week and someone decided to ask him, would you like to do the rematch with Floyd? And he was like, yeah, I'd do the rematch with Floyd. And just like, move the fuck on. Everyone else has. You know, no one in boxing whose opinion is worth two shits actually thinks about Floyd Mayweather anymore. But anyway, let's do some news that's not related to just straight up con jobs. Cejudo versus TJ is confirmed. That's not to do with the con job because Demetrius Johnson no longer around. Way trigger them DJ fans. If only DJ had taken. And TJ's going to do it at 125 like he always said he would. But, you know, whatever. Henry Cejudo, very good fighter, but I think TJ's probably... Yeah. Well, you know, I can't... We keep counting Henry Cejudo out and he keeps winning, so, you know, fair enough to him. But, oh, actually, I don't know if we touched on this, but the UFC flyweight division is shutting down. They're closing the doors. They're sending some of them up to bantamweight, and then they're just letting the others go. They're sending Ray Borg up to bantamweight, which is probably the least they could do, given the shitty year he's had. But, yeah, just formally giving up on that class. I can't remember if we talked about that last time, or if we just got the news that Demetrius Johnson was leaving, and, you know, we were speculating. But now it's pretty much confirmed. A lot of the UFC flyweights have announced that they've been given their marching orders. In terms of fight announcements, really interesting one come out. Gegard Mousasi versus Rafael Lovato at Bellator 214. Obviously, Lovato, not a hugely experienced guy. Certainly nowhere near the, whatever it is, 100 fights that Gegard Mousasi has. But there's no one else for Mousasi to fight in that division. And Lovato is very good. And, you know, one of the most accomplished American BJJ competitors of all time. And he seems to be adapting it to MMA well. He's also enormous and roidy. Hits well. And, you know, Gegard Mousasi's thing is always being the well-rounded fighter who's good in every area but not great in any area. And, you know, he gets beaten by guys who are very, very good in one area when he can't get it to the other area, like, you know, having to strike with Machida or having to wrestle and grapple with Jacare. So, you know, it's a sort of fight that, when you think of it like that, you can give Lovato a decent chance. If he can get a hold of Mousasi and get him to the mat, he's got a good chance of it. But I don't know why I'm bothering to hype that fight up. You know, like, it's not my job to make these Bellator fights look interesting, but I have been following Lovato, and he's always good fun. He does that thing that Damian Maia does where he'll go for the takedown, fail on the takedown, pull half guard, and then come up on the takedown again as soon as the guy's hips settle. Really nice, up on the single leg, that is. Or the dog fight. A bit of sad news came out a couple of weeks ago. Rachel Ostovich, who was slated to fight... Was she slated to fight Paige VanZant? I can't remember who she was fighting. But she was hospitalised after an assault, and everyone was saying, oh, God, did she get in a fight in a bar like, what's her name, Juliana Pena used to do all the time. But no, it was her fucking husband, her piece of shit MMA fighter husband. And this is the second one of these we've had lately. The previous one was Andrea Lee? Yeah, Angela Lee is the one in one. Yeah, Andrea Lee, her piece of shit husband, who actually committed murder at one point, which is even more incredible. Shot a black guy in a car, if I remember correctly. And had all those Nazi tattoos, and everyone was just like, well, it's his past. He's still got the Nazi tattoos. Could pay for them to be taken off at any point. Yeah, you know, when the UFC were trying to get into New York and they were having the New York Assembly hearing, and I watched that Assembly hearing and it was 3 hours just utter nonsense. You know, random black women standing up and going, my kids use the nunchucks and have all that and they love it. And I don't know why they're Southern, but they are. But and I love martial arts because of that. And then another woman being like, how are we going to stop the teachers from raping the children? And you're like, this isn't about teaching martial arts. This is about legal competition on a professional level. So yeah, it was utterly mind-blowing how little everyone knew, but how confidently everyone would speak about the bill that they were debating. Incredible. But the thing that they did hit on was that there's a lot of domestic abuse in MMA. And there is. There's tons of it. And I don't know why. Well, I do know why. But firstly, CTE. You know, guys are going to get brain damage and it does affect your emotions. Secondly, some of the people who get into MMA are people who were fighting anyway, had tempers and violence in their life, and someone said you could do this professionally. And of course, you know, if you're a man with a hammer, every problem is a nail. And I think that's just you have one tool, you're good at violence, and on the surface, everything, if you get deep enough into it in any argument, it's a fist fight eventually, you know, and so if you're the best at fist fighting, you should be able to win any argument. But obviously it doesn't actually work out like that. It's just a very lizard brain way to think. You know, whom amongst us hasn't thought, if I could just travel back in time and if Hitler had just caught these hands, think of how many lives would be saved. You know, people really overestimate what violence can do for them, and especially in the moment. Still, this guy's a piece of shit. But then, you know, like the Andrew Lee thing, we found out that they'd both been taking chunks out of each other for weeks from some guy who'd been living with them. Just fucked up shit, you know. But then, you know, don't shit where you eat. Don't date other MMA fighters if you're an MMA fighter, because you might end up in a fight with them, especially if they're a piece of shit. I'm really overgeneralizing here. There are hundreds and hundreds of great fighters who, when they get angry, just go, okay, and walk off to another room and breathe or whatever they do. You know, they're just normal, well-adjusted people. But there is a really high number, not percentage, but number of total shitlords in MMA, apparently. Anyway, on to more positive news. We'll do some from the grappling community, actually. There were rumors floating around earlier last week. I think it was Brett Okamoto, so normally a pretty good rumor. But of the UFC trying to sign Cron Gracie, which would be very, very interesting. Cron Gracie is a guy who... He's another one of those ones like Dylan Danis, who... I don't want to lump him in with Dylan Danis because he's much better than Dylan Danis, but who has been like, oh, I'm working full-time for MMA now, but doesn't actually fight ever. He did, however, fight Tatsuya Karajiri when Tatsuya Karajiri had just left the UFC. Off, I think it was a split decision loss to Cub Swanson. So, you know, Karajiri was washed, but not as washed as he could be. And Cron just styled all over him. He doesn't really have much striking, and he will pull guard in a fight, you know, jump closed guard. And you're thinking, at the highest levels, mate? But, you know, that's the exciting thing. I'd like to see him at the highest levels. And the fun thing about Cron Gracie is that he, even in the gi, he really didn't play an awful lot of, like, fancy guards. Everything he did was just to, like, drag the opponent into closed guard or come up on the single. And from closed guard, he had a wicked guillotine, like a classical guillotine, not even a high elbow guillotine. I think John Danaher called it a low elbow guillotine, but he was very, very good at it. Almost caught Marcelo Garcia with it. But, yeah, he was just always sort of like a... He did win his division in ADCC once Marcelo left, but he was always sort of like a... almost the best. And then he left almost immediately after winning ADCC. And he obviously, if you haven't heard, he's Hickson Gracie's son, but Hickson really didn't have an awful lot to do with training him, because Hickson was on his, like, rediscovery of himself adventure down in Brazil, banging lots of women, apparently, and having a terrible back. Actually, Hickson came out this week and was all, like, moaning about jiu-jitsu and the state of it again, and you're like, you sell gun defenses online. That's your job, mate. You know, don't be complaining about jiu-jitsu getting too much like karate or some shit if you're teaching Krav Maga gun defenses and basic hip throws. And then the other interesting piece of grappling news is that Gordon Ryan announced he's going to be doing some combat jiu-jitsu. Combat jiu-jitsu is fantastically stupid. If you've never seen it, I struggled to get into it, but some people love it. It's basically jiu-jitsu with open-handed strikes on the mat. And they used to do it at the Eddie Bravo Invitationals, and now they do their own events, I think. But this one's really interesting, because you've got Gordon Ryan, who has never done any MMA, but is the best no-gi grappler in his division in the world, possibly, except, you know, Vinny Magalhaes beat him the other day. Vinny Magalhaes is a fantastic MMA, well, very good MMA fighter, and also one of the best grapplers in the world. And then you've got Josh Barnett and Fabricio Verdum. You know, those two guys are guys who've fallen out with the UFC over USADA stuff. They've got to do something in the meantime, and this is a way that they can legally compete. Actually, I'm thinking about it now, and it's still, you know, they allow people to grapple, but this is grappling with strikes, so they could, if they wanted to, they could just be like, no, Verdum, you're under contract. Sorry, mate, you can't do it. And you could see, like, a last-minute switch out. Don't write that one off. That's a possibility. But in the meantime, you've got this four-man tournament that they've apparently done, and I think it's Ryan versus Verdum and Magalhaes versus Barnett, which then goes into the final, whoever wins those two. But that's pretty cool. And what you get there is you get a really, really top-notch jiu-jitsu guy who is decent at MMA in Vinny Magalhaes, another top-notch guy who's very good in MMA in Fabricio Verdum, a guy with his own unique style of grappling who is very good in both a no-gi or a submission-only and a MMA context in Josh Barnett. And you've got Gordon Ryan, who's almost a pure grappler, and hasn't done any of the striking stuff. So we get to test that old theory of if you hit a black belt in the face, he becomes a brown belt, and if you hit him again, he becomes a purple belt. So really exciting stuff, and it came out of nowhere. But I reckon that's all the news we need to cover this week. So let's get into the sad stuff. Golden Boy MMA 1. What the fuck was that all about, eh? If you watched this, and you paid for it, you're a sucker. I did, because obviously, you know, I'm an MMA journalist, and I have to do what's right, but if you paid for it, you know, shame on you. From the moment this fight was announced, everyone knew exactly what it'd be. You know, you don't have to be a genius to look at the fact that, you know, aside from the fact that Chuck's 48, you know, people will say Tito's 43. Well, Tito will say Tito's 43. Tito is the only person who was impressed by this, except Chris Cyborg. You know, anyone who knew Chuck Liddell knew that he was crocked. And that's not just his age. His body is crocked. Small punches were putting him out cold, face down for minutes at a time. Then you started seeing the footage of him training, and it was abundantly clear that he can't move anymore. Something with either his hips or his legs or something is crocked, because he can't walk properly. You know, it reminded me of going to see Elton John last year. You know, he got on the piano and he was amazing, and then as soon as he walked on or off stage, you were like, Jesus Christ, this dude's really fucking old. Meltzer pointed out that, like, you could see that he couldn't walk, and if you can't walk, you can't punch. And they were showing all this pad footage of him hitting, and he was clearly arm punching these pads, and people were still going, well, you know, you've not felt that punch, it might have mad power. And Frank Mir was having to say things like, well, Chuck's never been a guy who looks good on the pads, some guys just don't. And Rashad was really earning his money. Oh, Rashad, you've beaten both these men, what do you think? Oh, I think they're better tonight than even when I fought them 10 years ago. Just desperate. And they got Todd Grisham in, which is how you ruin any card. That guy's chloroform personified. Just shit at his job and boring too. You know, be one or the other, at least be Mike Goldberg. Actually, I'm not going to talk extensively about Bellator, because there was only one Bellator event. And if you watched it, it was shit. Phil Davis versus Nemkov. I was so psyched about that fight. And then I remembered, oh, it's a Phil Davis fight, after the fight had started, and it became a Phil Davis fight. And Nemkov actually won, which I forgot because I was so bored. But that booth, the commentary booth, is just the worst ever assembled. I've not actually watched the whole of the Pitbull fight, because I've tried three times to get through that event and given up every time, because Big John and Goldie just won't shut up about some shit that's nothing to do with the fight. Someone on Reddit put it really well when they said the cage could burn to the ground and Goldie and Big John would just keep talking about Cindy Dandois' training partners or some shit. Genuinely, Mike Goldberg and Big John McCarthy have made Bellator unwatchable. I could not watch that event. And I think the only type of person who actually cares about having Goldberg there, and they are around, you know, you can look at any Mike Goldberg status, because he spends his entire day retweeting and arguing with haters. You can read any Mike Goldberg status, and there are loads of people underneath going, you are the best part of Bellator, I love the part where you shout it's all over. You can't underestimate the dribbling retard. There are a large proportion of dribbling retards watching fights, and their money is just as good as anyone else's, especially if you're on TV and it doesn't even matter if they pay. But yeah, this booth, almost as bad as Bellator's booth, but not quite, because Frank Mir is actually pretty good. And Rashad, when he's not just lying full-time, is pretty good too. But didn't watch much of this card, only watched T-Bow versus Efren Escudero. Escudero looked tiny next to T-Bow. But then T-Bow's been a welterweight before, hasn't he? And I think Escudero's gone down to featherweight at some point. But yeah, Gleison T-Bow turned up, and it turns out that in his time off, all he's been doing is lateral raises. They just came in with these capped delts. You know, like fucking porterhouse steak on each shoulder. With this weird beard, he looked like a roidy Ben Kingsley. I said, this dude's browning up away from winning an Oscar. But yeah, it was kind of like Bender and Flexo. It was evil Gleison T-Bow turned up and just did what he normally does. And Efren Escudero took him down, which is really impressive, because if you remember, and this is the only thing that you need to remember about Gleison T-Bow's career, he's very hard to take down, and Habib couldn't. He did still look not special at all. Like, Gleison T-Bow did not look like he was going to step in with Khabib Nurmagomedov and get the win anytime soon. I think Khabib has moved along since 2013, and Gleison T-Bow has just got older and worse. The sad one was the return of Tom Lawlor, who really got fucked over by the UFC and USADA. He got suspended for a while, and then the UFC kept him until the end of suspension and then cut him, which is nothing but malicious, really. Like, if you know you're going to cut the dude, and they would have known at some point before the end of the suspension that they wanted to cut him, just cut him, you know? Let them go and earn their money, like fucking Wanderlei Silva. There's no point, if you don't want someone in your organisation, there's no point denying them a career just because, you know, you can. So Lawler was fighting this lad called Darren Wynn, who looked like he had no business being in the light heavyweight class. Really small guy. I think he was like 5'5 or something. Basically like a mini DC. He was DC's protege and was sort of swanging and banging and eventually got some takedowns in the second and third, or maybe it was just the third, I can't remember really. But I do remember that Tom Lawler was looking for this check hook all night, and it was the same one that he was landing against Corey Anderson. But he just didn't show a lot of variety, and he looked a little bit, well, understandably a little bit rusty because he's not fought since March 2016. I like Tom Lawler a lot. I think, I was watching the fight screaming, please kick him, but when you've got a guy who you know is just going to try and take you down, obviously a little bit trickier to try and do that. But then the commentary team were talking like Wynn was dominating from the opening bell to the last, and it just wasn't like that. It was really weird. Darren Wynn, interesting one to keep an eye on, especially if he goes down to, at least middleweight. That guy looks like he could make welterweight, but I'm more inclined to say be a Kelvin Gastelum-style figure. Just fight at middleweight and be big, or chunky at least, and win fights there. Nothing else really went on the rest of the card. Guys like James Barnes, Ricky Palacios, he had a Palacios knockout of Well L. Watson, which was really nice. I think he caught him with a stepping right hook along the cage or something like that, but it was a real... That was basically your quality knockout of the night. There was nothing else going on. And then finally you had Tito versus Chuck, and it was every bit as lame and sad as you would hope for. Tito came out to music that went, who's in the house? Tito's in the house, way! And then he came out, unironically, to Limp Bizkit. I used Limp Bizkit at the start of this show, ironically, but someone genuinely got the stuff together and went, what's cool to enter to? Oh, we should enter some Limp Bizkit. I want people to know that it's his way or the highway. And then Chuck Liddell came out and, oh God, just struggled even walking to the cage. I wrote about this, but everyone, the whole thing we all cling to is power is the last thing to go. Remember George Foreman, power is the last thing to go. And Chuck had power, and now he doesn't. And it became abundantly clear, they circled each other for like a minute, and then Chuck hit him square in the head, and it did nothing. And it was clear that Chuck was just arm punching, didn't have any idea like why it wasn't working, like couldn't get his head around the fact that he's just slow and old and crocked. And Tito finally realised, oh wait, I could just walk in on this guy. And they both threw punches and fell over at one point or another. They are both bad old men, but at least Tito Ortiz stays in great shape and can take a shot. So he finally catches Liddell along the fence. And Liddell takes the hit, and it isn't like his brain turns off. His eyes go wide, and he looks like, oh no, not again. And then his legs just crumble underneath him, and he falls flat on his face. He has the strangest reaction to being hit. And it's the same with all these knockouts. Like, he gets hit, and it looks like he's very much conscious of the fact that he's been hit. And he's going, oh no, and then falls down. So I was listening to Dave Meltzer talk about possible buy rates for this one, and he was saying that he suspects somewhere above 70,000, which would be very sad, you know, because really only one guy needed to buy it to stream it for the rest of us. And I think 70,000 would be an interesting one, but I don't know if that would keep Oscar De La Hoya. I desperately don't want Oscar De La Hoya in the MMA business. The guy is just scum. Very good boxer, but scum. This is the logical conclusion to all the Bellator old man fights. And Scott Coker pretending he's above this when he booked Shamrock versus Gracie 3 the other year is just laughable. But yeah, so Meltzer was working it out. And the whole thing about this is that Tito and Chuck have both signed agreements that give them a percentage of pay-per-view revenue plus whatever it was, 250,000. They were trying to work out, you know, if Tito would make over a million or whatever. Someone was saying on Reddit, you know, you'd only need to sell 100,000 pay-per-view buys. And I was saying, the UFC couldn't sell 200,000 pay-per-view buys with Yoel Romero versus Robert Whittaker. I think they sold 150 the second time round, and people knew that they had the best fight of the year, basically, in their previous fight, and then they had it again, and people just didn't care. We are in a very strange state of things where we can't get people to buy pay-per-views anymore, probably because people know it's a massive rip-off to pay $40, $50, $60 for a night of fights, when you can basically, like, they're very easy to get illegally. And a lot of the cards are just offensive, to be honest, in terms of quality. And there's so fucking many of them, too. But Meltzer was doing the math, but I think he was counting it all as like $50, $40 sales. Remember that these went... They started cutting prices very, very early. They went down to 30... I think it was $30 around Halloween time. And since then, they went down to like 14. So it looked like people were not buying this one. I don't think we'll ever get an announcement on how many it did. I think we might get a lie positively about how many it did if Oscar wants to keep going in MMA. But I think what you'll probably get is Oscar not really saying much about it. And it was just awful. Tito won the fight, went nuts, because for him this was his Everest. Like, for Tito Ortiz was the only person this mattered for. And he was running around the cage like he'd just beaten Chuck Liddell in his prime. And doing the Gravedigger celebration finally, because, you know, he never ever stops anyone, so he could actually do it this time. And then immediately after the fight, he starts talking, which is just the worst. Like, Tito Ortiz can't talk. Why is he taking the mic and making it all about himself when he is shit at talking? But while Chuck's standing there, having been knocked out, they interview him when he's been knocked out, because obviously they do. And Tito starts saying things like, well, now he's buried the hatchet, but I would love you to keep fighting for Golden Boy MMA. And he basically begged him to keep going and was like, thanks, Oscar, on it. Like, Oscar wasn't there. They didn't show Oscar at any point. And Tito's just begging Chuck to take another fight so that they can make some more money. Absolutely tragic. The stupidest thing is that the California State Athletic Commission licensed this. And they are just the scum of the earth for doing that, you know. Basically, if they think they can make more than $1,000 and get something out of it, they'll license you, regardless of whether you might die or not. I mean, how stringent are the medicals if a guy who can't walk and has been, you know, has his lights turned off by the slightest contact can get through at age 48? Yeah, it just reminds me of when Robert Fitzsimmons was fighting into his 50s. And they didn't have commissions back then. And basically all the newspaper writers were going, can we please talk about Bob Fitzsimmons? Someone needs to do something. There needs to be some kind of government body who'll fucking stop him. But anyway, that was that. Let's talk about the real fights that happened in the meantime, though. So Korean Zombie versus Yair Rodriguez was the first one we missed. And that was a banger. I thought the Korean Zombie did a great job of tooling Yair up. You know, Yair, like... Zabit has pretty poor ring craft and awareness, can be really bothered by feints and jabs, and Chan Sung-jung was doing a really good job of placing his jab out there, slipping and coming back with counters. Rodriguez did well get into the leg early on, but even on the side kicks, you saw Wang Chun of the song. You know, you saw the Korean Zombie withdrawing his lead leg from those lead leg side kicks and from the round kicks eventually, and Yair really stopped having success with them in the middle rounds. Really, like, it was Jung being the old Jung that got him in trouble here, because he lost it with 1 second left in the last round because he obliged Yair Rodriguez in this stupid, like, stand and trade in the middle Max Holloway stuff. Had he not dive face first into the last trade, he would have won an easy decision and continued on. But props to Yair Rodriguez. You know, he was losing that fight, but that is the biggest win of his career. Folks are still going to complain that he's ducking Zabit. The whole Zabit thing is so fucking stupid. People be like, he's ducking Zabit, and you go, how do you know that? Why? That's the worst part of boxing. People claiming to have some kind of like positive, not, you know, actually knowing what's going on in negotiations, and they go, because Zabit's always tweeting about it, and you're like, that's fucking Ali Abdulaziz. Zabit doesn't speak English and doesn't tweet. And also, Zabit was like offered the Hinato Moicano fight and didn't step in at short notice, so, you know. And the other one was that they put Volkanovski and Mendez into a fight against each other, and I was like, well, that's good, that frees them both up to not fight Zabit, which is the most important thing. Zabit is just the most overrated fighter in MMA right now. He's great, but he is super overrated on what he's done. Some guy was telling me that they knew he was title ready because he wrestles. I was going, what wrestling titles has he won? They were like, well, no, he wrestles. He's not like Israel Adesanya, who is a striker and been protected. He's like, you know, he just fought Derek Brunson, and Derek Brunson was chasing a takedown constantly from the first bell. And this dude was like, well, no, I don't believe that. The stupidest argument I've ever been involved in. But there are people who think like that. You know, I was talking about this in my most recent article when we were talking about Ingari versus Blades. People are desperate to know what the most important skill in MMA is. And it's wrestling. Like, that will always be the answer because that controls whether you're standing or on the ground. But if you're talking about the most important skill, you're not good enough to make it at the highest levels. Like, you can't... The fact that Curtis Blades doesn't have any striking that's serviceable at the highest levels, you know, that he can't throw hands for a couple of minutes with guys who he thinks are bigger hitters than him, that is why he won't be the top dog. You know, you've got to be comfortable. It's far better to be comfortable throwing hands with someone than it is to be good at throwing hands and they not want to when they're scary. You've got to be able to do some of everything. And people are desperate to be like, no, you just wrestle. Just focus all your time on wrestling and you'll win. But anyway, enough about Zabit. The other fights on that card was Cerrone versus Perry, which had all that gym drama going in. We're not even going to bother touching on that because just the lamest. It's the lamest part of boxing is the pretending you know who's ducking who and then saying it with authority. The lamest part of MMA is gym beef. But yeah, Mike Perry stuffed Donald Cerrone's usual like weird. Donald Cerrone has this thing that Henan Brown did too, which is when he wants a takedown, he ducks his head straight forward and then lunges in. He's really bad at initiating takedowns. And Perry saw it, pulled him up into the clinch, tripped straight into side control. And then, you know, Cerrone is just that good on the floor that he managed to reverse it all. He was keeping the crossface off. Perry reached over his head and Cerrone just got up to his knees and rolled him over. It was really good stuff. Very similar to the Marcelo Garcia sort of elbow push escapes. And then he gets the triangle position from the top and turns it into an armbar. Lovely stuff. I thought Perry... That was the sort of fight where it would benefit Perry to just fight like Perry. You know, Donald Cerrone is a slow starter who really struggles if people get in his face and start hitting him with punches. He's a guy who really needs time to get into his groove and distance to work his best techniques. And Perry didn't do any of that. He stood there sort of tentatively, not sure what to do. That's the sort of fight where his team should have been like, just be you, run in and knock him out. But he didn't. So, you know, that's that. Jermaine Verandamy returned against Raquel Pennington, and it was every bit as bad as you'd expect. Those two are like top five in the weight class. Cut that weight class. It's useless. Benil Dariush returned. Yeah, not an awful lot of interesting stuff on that card. Derby Ramos got his submission victory. Yay. And there was a Bravo choke. Bobby Moffitt beat Chaz Skelly by Bravo, which is always good. Or Das, depending on what you want to call it. Then there was Magny versus Ponzinibbio, which was the first UFC event from Argentina. And that wasn't bad, I thought. There were a few things on there. I really like Marlon Vera. He's always good fun with his ankle sleeves and so on. There was some nice stuff in that fight where the guy was kneeling along the fence and trying to hold his wrist. And the other, I think it was Vera, stepped on the other guy's wrist and pulled his hand out and started hitting. Did some nice, like, jumping knees into the double collar tie clinch, whatever you want to call it. So that was good. Michael Prezeris was on the card, won by Guillotine Choke. That dude is a fridge. Ian Heinich beat Cesar Ferreira. Cesar Ferreira was a real hot prospect a little while ago. But he just did not look to have it in this fight. But this was an interesting one because Heinich would walk forward, feint, and then step in. And that was all, like, feint, step in for real. Feint, step in for real. So he was getting timed with takedowns and counters pretty consistently. He was just lucky that none of them really actually did him any damage. Could have ended very badly indeed. Johnny Walker was breakout boy of the card, fought Khalil Roundtree. And if you compare this performance to Gökhan Saki's performance against Khalil Roundtree, you can see why one worked and one didn't. Johnny Walker was fainting from the opening bell. And then when he decided to go, he went, and he really went after it, you know, kick, punch, 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 slap on the double collar tie, and then hold on to it for dear life. If you watch the Gökhan Saki fight, Saki circles, 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 never throws a feint, steps in and kicks full power to the leg, and Roundtree just shoots up the center and knocks him out. But yeah, this one was nice. It got the double collar tie. Obviously, Roundtree was freaking out about the knee because the guy's 6'6". It's going to be very easy for him to bring a knee up to your chin. And then he just hit him with a couple of snapping elbows around the side. And those short ones, they really do they're a surprisingly stiff connection over a very short distance that you don't see coming. Ricardo Lamas completed his transition into boyhood. I used to hate this guy. I used to just not want to watch him at all. I think it was the Aldo fight where he threw a low kick and a wheel kick 100 times and didn't do anything else. And that was Eldo at like full conservative mode too. So that was when people were going, oh my God, someone please beat Eldo. I'm so bored of him being too good and not actually doing much with it. You know, that was the one, he'd take the guy down and go from Butterfly Guard straight into Mount, just on a whim, and then he'd go, okay, well, that's enough for this round, I'm going to take the rest of the round off. But Lamas has really grown on me. He has one of the most interesting guards in MMA, and nobody really talks about it. If you watched him versus Bektik, you know, if you can sweep Bektik, if you can get up from under Bektik, you're doing well. But if you can sweep Misad Bektik, you're doing very well indeed, sir. And he did it by, he's taken down into half guard, which is where he got one leg trapped and he had a knee shield in. And he opened his legs and switched so that he had the knee shield all the way through on the opponent's other, on his man's other hip with his foot inside. So he had like a wrong-sided butterfly hook and the other foot was on the outside. And that's typically not a good position. That'd be like the sort of position a passer wanted. But he had a grip over the back and Bektik looked like he was going to try and arm triangle him or something like that. And then he just did like a reverse, a wrong side butterfly sweep and took him all the way overhead and came up on top. And he does that and he, you know, if they resist the sweep, he can put the hand to the floor and cut and do a stand up. And if they try and chase him back or try and like bulldog him back down, he just throws his hip out to the right and grabs the guillotine choke. It's these three things that work in succession. I wrote some of it in the art. Look up the Magny versus Ponzinibbio article. It's on the Fight Primer. But I put in a couple of clips of it, and he does it in every fight. And he swept. I pointed it out on. I put a little clip of it on Facebook and said we're talking about it in the article. And he, Lamas himself came in and was like, "I also did it to Charles Oliveira." It's like, "Oh, thanks, Ricardo." And I immediately checked it out. And it, yeah, he's really shit hot off his back. And the interesting thing is that he, the way he gets up is quite similar to the way that he caught Cub Swanson getting up. When Cub Swanson got up, he slapped on the arm triangle choke and took him down again with it and finished. So yeah, really interesting how he skirts that line. He looks like he's in bad position, but he always has that offside sweep and the opportunity to get back up. And of course he threw like 100 wheel kicks in this fight and didn't land one of them and got taken down off one, but that's just Lamas on the feet. His striking has actually improved a lot. I think he's one of those guys. And, you know, we're going to talk about this with Blades. I use Ryan Bader as an example too, who just, if he has confidence on the feet against the opponent, he's really, really good. But if he's not got the confidence there, you know, if he thinks he's on a level with the opponent or they're better than him, it all just disappears, you know. And there are a few guys like that where it's not sort of, you get slow diminishing returns. You know, you don't get like, oh, I do really well against this guy, and then if they're a little bit better, I don't do quite as well, but I'm still doing well. It's just like there's this watershed where you're either killing it or you're not doing anything at all. And then Ponzinibbio versus Magny, this was an absolute ass-whooping. On paper, I was looking at that match going, firstly, not that interested, but secondly, yeah, that sounds like a good even fight, you know, and it just did not turn out like that at all. Ponzinibbio had his number, and it was the same stuff that Larkin was doing to Ponzinibbio, he was doing it to both of them, but it was the same stuff Larkin was doing to Magny. You know, hack at that lead leg, put him on the cage, beat him up when he's there. And Magny's corner really, you know, people were focusing on them not stopping the fight, but I think just the advice was really bad. Their entire focus, I mean, obviously you only get like half because they do one corner and then the other and then sometimes they do replays, but I didn't hear anyone at any point say get off the fence. I heard them say go first, back him up, which is why Magny was trying to jab off the fence and it just wasn't working. He'd jab and try and step out to his left in like a safety lead and immediately Ponzinibbio would kick him in the leg and it'd buckle again. You know, this is the same problem that Raymond Daniels had when he was in the ring, trying to fight out of corners instead of moving. You are at a massive disadvantage when you're back to the fence and you're crowded, you know, and if you try and fight your way off the fence, you're giving the opponent what they want. You're standing in front of them and letting them hit you. And it was as he was like hopping around on one leg in the fourth round after taking yet another hard low kick, he jabbed and Ponzinibbio came across the top with the right hand and turned his chin just right. It was one of those ones that didn't look like half as bad as half the shots that had already landed, but somehow still just caught the button and knocked him out. Yeah, Magny is a weird one, because when he looks good, he looks good, and when he looks bad, he looks extremely bad. But he's still, you know, levels above what's outside the UFC. You know, they brought that Craig White guy in, And Magni finished him with one knee. Like, it was effortless. Makes me wonder, like, what Lawrence Larkin would do against these guys now. Because I was talking to people and they'd just, like, forgotten that Lawrence Larkin is any good. And you're going, when did he look rubbish? And they go, oh, in the Lima fight. And you're like, nothing happened in the Lima fight. They both did nothing. Except, you know, they landed a couple of strikes each. And that was it. That's not looking bad. That's just looking tentative. Which is pretty much Larkin's MO. He'll have one good fight and then he'll beat some, you know, where he beats someone up. And then he'll have a bad fight where he does nothing. He never looks like outmatched or outgunned. His only really bad performance lately was when he got caught with a spinning back fist out of the clinch by Paul Daly, which was completely, you know, aside from that, the fight was fine. You know, he's not had this decline in skills. And if anything, like, nothing Magni showed looked like he could beat Larkin. And I don't know, Ponzinibbio is getting better, but I still don't know if he could really deal with Larkin, because Larkin has these really annoying little habits, like checking across the body with his left hand. He'll check your left hand with his left hand and, like, smother your jab that way, which would be very annoying if you're Ponzinibbio and you've been working on your jab. Actually, let's talk about Ponzinibbio's jab, because if he's finding Magni's eye, like his right eye, over and over again with his fist, can we say that the eye pokes that have changed many of his fights have been deliberate? You know, clearly he values hitting the eye, which is fair enough. You know, Muhammad Ali was one of the greatest at hitting the eye. And it's important to be able to hit the opponent in the eye, you know. But if he understands the target and he values it, I don't think it's coincidence that he's fingered dudes in the eye several times in his career at, you know, pretty opportune points. Poor old Gunnar Nelson's still fucking out of action. But yeah, I mean, aside from that, he looked great. I'm not going to get on him about cheat. Some people were like he was reaching for the eye in this fight. I didn't really see it. I went back and checked, and they did seem to all be punches, the ones that hurt Magni's eye. I talked about this in the post-fight article, actually. Muhammad Ali's a really interesting one, because he threw a backhanded jab so that he was jabbing the opponent's left eye, which would hide his right hand immediately afterwards. And, like, if you see the swelling that he put on guys like Henry Cooper, just incredible. Though Henry Cooper was a legendary bleeder. And then the final event that happened while we were away was the Blades vs. Ngannou 2, which was in Beijing just the other night / morning, depending on whenever you... I think it was Saturday morning in America. It was Saturday sort of like midday time in the UK, which I really appreciated. It's almost like Rising, which is croissant time on a Sunday, and that's perfect. What was good on this card? Lewis Smolka got a win by submission in his return. Love that lad. He shouldn't really have been cut in the first place. He's one of those guys like Darren Cruikshank and Lando Venata has just been cut too. You know, these guys who are really entertaining in good competitive losses to top guys. And then you're like, well, got to cut you. That's the rules now. And you're going, really? But what else happened? Song Yadong was decent against Vince Morales. You know, 30-27 across the board, but it wasn't super amazing. Like, yeah, I'm ready to see him against good guys now. You know, better guys, rather. Li Jiangliang, scored a sidekick to the body TKO, Bill Wallace style, which was awesome. He really is... I have very mixed feelings about him because he does cheat. You know, he was landing late blows in this fight. He famously tried to gouge Jake Matthews' eye out to get out of a guillotine. But he does have a very entertaining style in terms of he starts slow, getting hit a lot, and then he starts to build up the pace and pick up steam. And you get to see, like, that race towards the finish. Like, is he going to be able to finish, or is the fight going to end, or whatever? But yeah, he did really good work in this one. And the sidekick was lush. And it really worked well because it came out of nowhere. It wasn't something that he's really used that much before. Whereas Bill Wallace used to have success with it because it was his go-to. It was jab sidekick, jab sidekick, jab sidekick, jab hook kick. You know, like, he'd knock dudes out with the hook kicks and the round kicks. But... actually told me this in person. He said, you know, people focus on the high kicks, but something like 15 of his 20-something knockouts came from side kicks to the solar plexus, because that was the one that he was always throwing. And then the other ones were like the variety that he threw in to mix things up. Alistair Overeem fought Sergey Pavlovich, you know, Mr. Tune-Up 2018. And Pavlovich could have given him trouble, because Overeem decided that he's no longer Econoreem, where he circles and moves. He's now going back to the double arms up covering style of defense. And if Pavlovich had actually thrown combinations on him and stayed on him, I think he could have stopped him very easily with uppercuts. I did not like what Alistair Overeem was doing here, but he did do some nice right hands into the clinch, coming in on the double collar tie. And the, you know, I love watching Alistair Overeem work from an underhook along the fence. He has the best knees to the body in the game, and he very rarely uses them as much as he could. And you saw, like, the end came because of those knees to the body. He'd got in on the knees to the body. So he goes right hand into the double collar tie, and rather than, like, standing upright and trying to shuck him off or something like that, Pavlovich picks up his knee to, like, stop. And if you see a guy picking up their knee, BJ Penn used to do it too, it's normally because they're quite concerned about the body shots, you know, if they're guarding their body with their leg. So Overeem tripped him. Well, you know, he just kicked the other leg out, threw him to the floor. Pavlovich, he stood in Pavlovich's guard, and Pavlovich just had his feet on his hips for the longest time. Didn't grab an ankle, wasn't trying to do anything like a tripod sweep or anything from there to try and get up. Just laid there with his feet on his hips. Didn't have any form of guard. Overeem very easily hit a throw by pass and then just elbowed and hammer fisted him into TKO. Sergei Pavlovich, not good. But then no one in this division is. Like, there's five good guys at heavyweight, and if you're better than absolute shit, you could be a top 20 heavyweight. And then in terms of good heavyweights, he had Francis Ngannou versus Curtis Blaydes, and we talked about this already, but Curtis Blaydes has serviceable striking, like, say, a Ryan Bader type, but confronted with someone who's actually scary, his striking just disappears, and it's the same as Overeem we were talking about. You know, Overeem can look amazing against Mark Hunt, who I would, you know, we'd be... You or I would be terrified of fighting Mark Hunt, but Overeem was fine with it. And then he's fighting Ben Rothwell or Francis Ngannou or Sergey Kharitonov, and he's suddenly throwing punches while trying to run in the opposite direction. You know, he does that thing where he, like, throws the punch, changes his mind halfway through, and sprints out the side door, and it just looks awful, and he's clearly worried about engaging them. And there was a little bit of that with Blaydes. Like, he's not comfortable throwing punches with dudes. And that's what made Stipe's performance so impressive. You know, he took Ngannou over a longer distance to tire him out. But also, from the early going, he was there throwing feints, throwing jabs, throwing right hands. He was legitimately trying to hurt Ngannou, but he was doing it in a way where he was pop, pop, and then safe. Lots of feints to get Ngannou swinging at air. He weathered the Ngannou early storm by not fighting particularly aggressive and giving him counterpunches. And then he completely removed the counterpunches from the equation later with feints and jabs. Blaydes was just jab, jab, takedown attempt, jab, you know. And that was the first fight too. And the first fight was Curtis Blaydes lands jab, Ngannou lands right hand over the top because Curtis Blaydes is standing still after his jab. And it happened again in this fight, except this time it knocked him out. So Ngannou, I thought he looked really good in the opening round, the opening seconds rather. The whole fight was the opening seconds. But I thought he looked really good because he flicked out the jab, rebounded away from his man to look for the check hook, dropped that same hand for the underhook and tried to hit the right hand on the break. It was really quick. And his movement has improved so much because I used to say, look at this guy. He'd step with his back foot up to his front foot and then his front foot out again. He didn't even know how to step. And now he's bouncing and looking light on his feet. It's pretty incredible. I think he's always going to have trouble because he's such a big hitter and he's not really boxing. He's just trying to crack dudes with big counters. I think he'll always have trouble with dudes who have a good jab and good feints. But those dudes don't exist at heavyweight. There's Stipe and that's it. Stipe has the jab at heavyweight. Maybe JDS. JDS could give him some trouble because JDS has feints and jabs and body shots. But, you know, guys like Kane and DC and that, they're not particularly slick on the feet. They have serviceable striking, which would play into their wrestling. But I think a lot of people, I said this on Twitter and in my article, but I think a lot of people looked at that Stipe fight and they saw the jabs, the feints, the low kicks, the right hands, the setups, the counters, and the beautiful level changes into the wrestling to get the match to the floor. And they went, yep, wrestling, that's Ngannou's problem, not beautiful fighting all around. So Ngannou back to being a force, you know, it gives some weight to that theory that people are desperate. People are desperate to ascribe this theory to me, and I've never said it, but people used to be like, he threw the fight with Lewis because he'd fallen out with the UFC management. I think if you're going to throw a fight, there's safer ways, well, not safer ways, but there are more convincing ways to do it than not throw any strikes while your opponent's not throwing any strikes. You know, that's just going to a close decision, and in MMA, that is no way guaranteeing the other guy will win. But yeah, not a bad fight all round. Let's do a couple of questions. Hijack is the Dom Cruise of the 52s. Oh my god, Kevin Holland did the 52 on the card. I've got to say that. Legend. It's the Dom Cruise of the 52s and the Hongman Choi of being your boy, Dan. My question is, with all the hype surrounding Ben Askren and DJ, if you could make one trade between two MMA orgs to benefit both, who would you trade and why? Love the podcast. Thanks, from Daniel. I think it's got to be Chandler. I'd trade Chandler for someone like... as fun as Edson Barboza is, I don't think he's making it to the top anytime soon. And I think he's someone who could benefit an organization like Bellator. So, you know, I think maybe they take Edson Barboza for Michael. Well, I don't think they would take him for Michael Chandler because Michael Chandler's their boy and Michael Chandler's desperate to not be drug tested. But, yeah, I think Michael Chandler. You know, there's all this talk now of having Patricio Pitbull come and fight in the UFC. Or rather, Patricio Pitbull keeps talking about how he's on the level of the guys in the UFC without ever proving it. So maybe Patricio Pitbull, the good Pitbull. Who would I trade for him? It's very hard to be fair to the other organization that's got that one talented fighter without losing one of those awesome fights that you'd like. Maybe they give him Aldo. You know, Aldo's not getting another title shot, but then he wants to fight Aldo. So having Aldo in the UFC and then trading for Pitbull is probably better. Give them Edgar. Yeah. Edgar is good enough, but probably not someone anyone wants to see in the title picture again anytime soon. Edgar for Patricio sounds good. And the entire UFC flyweight division, what was, for Kyoji Horiguchi, bring him in back in as a bantamweight. You know, he'll do fine. Cheers, Dan. Dear Jack, this may be something you covered before or common knowledge over in Europe, but I'd really enjoy a Patreon episode on the history of bare-knuckle boxing among gypsies. Pikey boxing, way! There was always your friend who had the pikey boxing VHSs, and you're like, it's a bit dirty feeling. They'd invite you over to watch the gypo boxing, and you go, I think I'd be more comfortable if we just watched hardcore pornography, to be honest. I find the whole culture around gypsies fascinating, but I understand if your plate is already full. Wishing you the best to my favourite fight journalist, the Bill Nye of jabbing eye, Jack Slag. Sincerely, Aaron. Yeah, I was actually talking about going over and doing like a extended new journalism style thing with some of the gypsy families, but I don't know, the whole thing's so unpalatable. Like, you know, I can appreciate it because sometimes some of them are pretty good and you go, oh well, that lad can actually throw hands and move his head, but the whole thing is just pretending it's about honor but it's actually about money, you know, all that. And he said, I shite in a bucket, and la la la. And you're like, well, no, it's actually about the side bet, isn't it? Your family are going to bet on you. His family are going to bet on him. There's going to be £10,000 in cash floating around. And that's what it's about. It's nothing to do with someone shitting in a bucket. If you don't know what that is, go watch Knuckle. But right, let's do some previews just before we kick it for the week. What we got going on this weekend? We've got Tyson Fury versus Deontay Wilder. That's the one I'll be writing for Unibet this week. That's a fun fucking fight because Deontay Wilder is known for getting Deontay Wilder than his opponents. Yeah, he'd just throw in windmills, basically, as Shannon Briggs famously said. Just throw, Deontay. What are they telling you in the corner? Just throw. No technique. But he is, you know, he was a good prospect as an amateur boxer. He can use his jab pretty well. It's just that right hand is what wins in fights, you know. And the more he throws it, the more he seems to win. But Tyson Fury is such a tricky fighter, and he's really grown on people since the Joe Rogan experience. You know, he does have all these weird religious views, and he's quite a bit of a misogynist, but he's very interesting as a character because he has the, you know, he's struggled with mental illness and extreme weight gain. But he also beat Vladimir Klitschko more convincingly than anyone else has, you know. It wasn't attractive, but he did make Vladimir Klitschko's job very, very hard, where Anthony Joshua did get the knockout of Klitschko. Klitschko also boxed him up for a large amount of that fight. So really, this if Fury wins this one, it sets up a fight with Joshua down the road. If Wilder wins, it sets up a fight with Joshua down the road. I think Fury's got a good chance of this one because he's tall, and that's often a problem for big right-hand swingers. You know, Fury, when we're talking about tall, in the modern heavyweight division, everyone's tall, but, you know, Wilder's swinging down on a lot of his opponents, whereas Fury is a gigantic dude. And Fury is just very good at moving in weird ways. The Lord moves in mysterious ways. The King of the Gypsies moves in mysterious ways. But if you watch him against Klitschko, he's throwing like a jab right hand, darting out to the side, and then backhanding in with the right again. He moves extremely well for a dude of his size. So I think he could make it very complicated for Wilder. I'd be very interested to see, because he doesn't really tie up as much as someone like Vladimir Klitschko, and I think that's the sort of thing that could keep him safer in a fight like this. But yeah, he's looking in incredible shape compared to what he's been in the past, and they've had him working up at Big Bear, and he was saying like he was doing 5 rounds and feeling like shit up at Big Bear, and then he came down and he's doing 12 rounds like a lightweight at regular altitude. I'd love to go somewhere like Big Bear. We just don't have mountains like that in the UK. You know, the closest we'd have is like if I went to the Alps. You know, you could go up Mam Tour or something like that, but it would just be useless. There's no difference between the air at the top and the air at the bottom. Yeah, so I've never really trained at altitude. Trained in like extreme humidity, which is always weird, but never trained at altitude. I think that'd be fun, but also horrible. Actually, props to Rodriguez and Jung, because that fight was in Denver, which is a pretty high city to begin with. Because it's in Colorado. No, but, you know, it's a decent altitude. And they do actually... Yair Rodriguez has done a couple of events, like I think he did Mexico City and a couple of others, where he was at extreme altitude and he still just went all out for the full, however long it was. Dude's got good conditioning. What else is going on? Oh, there's the Ultimate Fighter Final, which has... that's happening on the Friday night, I believe. Couple of interesting ones on that. Pedro Munoz, who I call the bantamweight for people who say that bantamweights are too fast, versus Brian Caraway. Mr. Guillotine versus Mr. Guard Pass. And you got the main event between Rafael Dos Anjos and Kamaru Usman. That's an interesting one, but again, you might be setting Rafael Dos Anjos up for another sort of... Colby Covington slappy striking and then looking for takedowns opponent. I mean, Dos Anjos is, I think, probably one of the best ever as a technician. And in terms of accomplishment too, you know, who does that? Wins the lightweight title, defends it a few times, goes out to welterweight and almost gets a title shot there. But Usman's a huge dude at that weight class. And he's not a bad striker either. He's one of those ones who's a bit meat and potatoes, but he's functional and he's happy to throw with whoever. And that is, like I said, more important than how slick you are if you're not going to use it. So that'll be fun. I mean, it's a lot of Dos Anjos' ability is kicking. And if he can't comfortably kick, and if he's put on the back foot a lot, you know, he's very good going forwards, not nearly as good going backwards. I'd love to see Rafael Dos Anjos against a Donald Cerrone or someone like that in the division, but Donald Cerrone's going back down to lightweight and he's already smashed him twice, so there's no point. I think, you know, Dos Anjos versus Stephen Thompson, that'd be a good fight. I've been playing a lot of UFC, EA UFC 3, because I've been ill. That and Red Dead Redemption. I've been role-playing as a rich man. You turn up in the city, and they're all like, oh, you cowpokes from the country. And I'd already bought, like, the nicest top hat on the game. And I'm just like, excuse me? But yeah, I've been spending a lot of time on the EA UFC while I'm waiting for my voice to heal. And I'm getting pretty good at smashing dudes with Rafael Dos Anjos. The other one I do is Michael Bisping at light heavyweight. Just humiliating light heavyweight, which is great fun. Everyone's playing Zabit, so I turn up as Moicano and just low kick him to death. That and left hook to the body overhand, over and over again. So many people that works on. Cheese strats, that's my game. The number of people who pick Conor McGregor and then try and hook kick you off the glove touch is just... it can't just be the same person over and over again. I think there are just that many douche nozzles. Oh, Joseph Benavidez is back on that card. Wow, he's hidden way down the bottom there. He looked so bad in his last fight. Yeah, I think he changed gym to, is it Extreme Couture? But he is not gelling with his striking coach there, because he looked like he'd forgotten everything that he ever knew about striking in his last fight. Hope he gets back on track. He's a fun fighter, especially in scrambles, actually. And then on that Dos Santos versus Tuivasa fight, which is happening in Adelaide, so it's going on Sunday morning, I believe. Oh, is that croissant time? I think it might be croissant time. We're having a rising card in the UFC, everybody. God, Yushin Okami. Fucking hell. Someone was trying to tell me that he's better than Derek Brunson, or he was in his prime better than Derek Brunson. I was like, Yushin Okami is not a great fighter. I don't care how much you love Anderson Silva, Yushin Okami was never a great fighter. He was a jab and some late, you know, boring wrestling. Wilson Hayes versus Ben Wynn, that's a fun fight. Actually, no, Wilson Hayes, Oh, yeah, that's the last flyweight fight, I remember, because they got Wilson Hayes in there so that no one complains. I hope Ben Wynn gets a huge knockout there and everyone complains that the division's going. Paul Craig's back. Way. Jake Matthews versus Tony Martin. Tyson Pedro versus Shogun Hua. I mean, Tyson Pedro should start Shogun, but he should have beaten Ovin St. Preux, and he managed to screw the pooch there. Is this Mark Hunt's retirement fight? I believe it is. It's supposed to be. Versus Justin Willis. Justin Willis, decent hands, and sort of like a shorter, pudgier heavyweight. So a good scrap for Mark Hunt. And also, I think he can probably stop the takedowns from Willis. You know, he was doing decently. He's done decently against good wrestlers. So I just worried this is setting up for like a boring decision wrestling loss in his last fight in front of his hometown. That'd be just tragic. And then you got Dos Santos versus Tuivasa in the main event. Tuivasa, I mean, seeing how he struggled with Arlovski, I think I was surprised how tiny he looks next to Arlovski. I think against Dos Santos, you know, Dos Santos' reactions have slowed and his chin's cracked a bit, but he's still a very good boxer in MMA, and he's also considerably bigger than Tuivasa. So it'd be interesting to see what happens there. I think Tuivasa should get to low kicks early and often. You know, start making up for Mark Hunt's lost time. All those low kicks that Mark Hunt didn't throw, start throwing those. Anyway, I reckon that'll do us for this week. I am about to finish The King on the River, which is a fucking 2-hour epic Patreon episode about a weird cult and Britain in China and so on, and then we're on to Muhammad Ali after that. So if you want to get involved in that or support the podcast, sign up to the Patreon. If you want to send the podcast an email and ask a question, fightsgonebypodcast@gmail.com, or if you just want to tell me to feel better. If you want to buy a t-shirt, they're in the link. We'll have the plain slacky logo ones up soon too. And if you want to see what I'm up to at any time, fightprimer.com. Make sure to check it this week because I'll be doing stuff for Vice and Unibet. I'm your boy Jack Slack. It feels good to be back. I hope I had the kind of energy that I needed, but I'm quite aware that my voice is still very croaky and annoying. I will catch you next week. Tito bless. What a cunt.